Jesus, close enough to touch, yet strong enough to trust. Master storyteller Max Lucado describes a savior who is as approachable as a next-door neighbor, yet mighty enough to save humanity on this W Audio presentation of his book, Next Door Savior, read by Chris Fabry. Our Next Door Savior. The words hang in the air like a just-rung bell. Who do you say that I am? Silence settles on the horseshoe of followers. Nathaniel clears his throat. Andrew ducks his eyes. John chews on a fingernail. Judas splits a blade of grass. He won't speak up, never does. Peter will, always does. But he pauses first. Jesus' question is not new to him. The previous 1,000 times, however, Peter had kept the question to himself. That day in Nain, he'd asked it. Most people stand quietly as funeral processions pass, mouths closed, hands folded, reverently silent. Not Jesus. He approached the mother of the dead boy and whispered something in her ear that made her turn and look at her son. She started to object, but didn't. Signaling to the pallbearer, she instructed, "Wait." Jesus walked toward the boy, eye level with the corpse. He spoke. Not over it as a prayer, but to it as a command. "Young man, I say to you, arise." With the tone of a teacher telling students to sit, or the authority of a mom telling kids to get out of the rain, Jesus commanded the dead boy not to be dead, and the boy obeyed. Cold skin warmed, stiff limbs moved, white cheeks flushed. The men lowered the coffin, and the boy jumped up and into his mother's arms. Jesus gave him back to his mother. An hour later, Jesus and the guys were eating the evening meal. He laughed at a joke and asked for seconds on bread, and the irony of it all jolted Peter. "Who are you?" he wondered so softly that no one but God could hear. "You just awakened the dead. Should you not be encased in light, or encircled by angels, or enthroned higher than 1,000 Caesars? Yet look at you, wearing clothes I would wear, and laughing at jokes I tell, and eating the food we all eat. Is this what death defeaters do? Just who are you?" And then there was the storm, the tie yourself to the mast and kiss your boat goodbye storm. 10-foot waves yanked the disciples first forward and then backward, leaving the boat ankle deep in water. Matthew's face blanched to the shade of Spetzel. Thomas death gripped the stern. Peter suggested that they pray the Lord's Prayer. Better still, that the Lord lead them in the Lord's Prayer. That's when he heard the Lord, snoring. Jesus was asleep, back against the bow, head drooped forward, chin flopping on sternum as the hull bounced on waves. "Jesus!" Peter shouted. The carpenter woke up, looked up. He wiped the rain from his eyes, puffed both cheeks with a sigh, and stood. He raised first his hand, then his voice, and as fast as you can say glassy, the water became just that. Jesus smiled and sat. And Peter stared and wondered, "Who is this? Even the wind and the waves obey him." This time Jesus is the one posing the question, "Who do you say that I am?" Perhaps Peter's reply had the tone of an anchor man on the 6 o'clock news, arched eyebrow, half smile, James Bondish baritone voice, "I believe that you are the Son of God." But I doubt it. I'm seeing Peter kick the dirt a bit, clear his throat, less swagger, more swallow, gulp, more like a first-time parachutist about to jump out of the plane. "Are you ready to jump?" he asked. "Who do you say that I am?" "I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God." If Peter was hesitant, you can hardly fault him. How many times do you call a callous-handed nail-bender from a one-camel town the Son of God? There was something wrong with the picture. We used to look at such scenes in elementary school. To keep us occupied, the teacher would pass out drawings with the question at the bottom, "What's wrong with this picture?" Remember them? We'd look closely for something that didn't fit. A farmyard scene with a piano near the water trough. A classroom with a pirate seated on the back row. An astronaut on the moon with a payphone in the background. We'd ponder the picture and point to the piano or pirate or payphone and say, "This doesn't fit. Something is out of place. Something is absurd. Pianos don't belong in farmyards. Pirates don't sit in classrooms. Payphones aren't found on the moon. And God doesn't chum with the common folk or snooze in fishing boats." But according to the Bible, He did. For in Christ there is all of God in a human body. Jesus was not a godlike man nor a manlike God. He was God-man, midwifed by a carpenter, bathed by a peasant girl, the maker of the world with a belly button, the author of the Torah being taught the Torah, heaven's human. And because He was, we are left with scratch-your-head, double-blink, what's-wrong-with-this-picture moments like these. Bordeaux instead of H2O. A cripple sponsoring the town dance, a sack lunch satisfying 5,000 tummies, and most of all, a grave guarded by soldiers, sealed by a rock, yet vacated by a 3 days dead man. What do we do with such moments? What do we do with such a person? We applaud men for doing good things. We enshrine God for doing great things. But when a man does God things? One thing is certain, we can't ignore Him. Why would we want to? If these moments are factual, if the claim of Christ is actual, then He was at once man and God. There He was, the single most significant person who ever lived. Forget MVP, He is the entire league. The head of the parade? Hardly. No one else shares the street. Who comes close? Humanity's best and brightest fade like dime store rubies next to Him. Dismiss Him? We can't. Resist Him? Equally difficult. Don't we need a God-man Savior? A just God Jesus could make us, but not understand us. A just man Jesus could love us, but never save us. But a God-man Jesus? Near enough to touch, strong enough to trust. A next-door Savior. A Savior found by millions to be irresistible. Nothing compares to the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. The reward of Christianity is Christ. Do you journey to the Grand Canyon for the souvenir T-shirt or the snow globe with the snowflakes that fall when you shake it? No, the reward of the Grand Canyon is the Grand Canyon, the wide-eyed realization that you are part of something ancient, splendid, powerful, and greater than you. The cash of Christianity is Christ, not money in the bank or a car in the garage or a healthy body or a better self-image, secondary and tertiary fruits perhaps, but the Fort Knox of faith is Christ. Fellowship with Him, walking with Him, pondering Him, exploring Him. The heart-stopping realization that in Him you are part of something ancient, endless, unstoppable, and unfathomable. And that He who can dig the Grand Canyon with His pinky thinks you're worth His death on Roman timber. Christ is the reward of Christianity. Why else would Paul make Him his supreme desire? I want to know Christ. Do you desire the same? My idea is simple. Let's look at some places He went and some people He touched. Join me on a quest for His God-manness. You may be amazed. More important, you may be changed. We all with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being changed into His likeness from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. As we behold Him, we become like Him. I experienced this principle firsthand when an opera singer visited our church. We didn't know his voice was trained. You couldn't have known by his corduroy coat and loafers, no tuxedo, cummerbund, or silk tie. His appearance raised no eyebrow, but his voice certainly did. I should know. He was in the pew behind me. His vibrato made dentures rattle and rafters shake. He tried to contain himself, but how can a tuba hide in a room full of piccolos? For a moment I was startled, but within a verse I was inspired. Emboldened by his volume, I lifted mine. Did I sing better? Not even I could hear me. My warbles were lost in his talent, but did I try harder? No doubt. His power brought out the best in me. Could your world use a little music? If so, invite heaven's baritone to cut loose. He may look as common as the guy next door, but just wait till you see what he can do. Who knows? A few songs with him might change the way you sing forever. Part 1. No Person He Won't Touch. Most of us had a hard time learning to tie our shoes. Squirting toothpaste on a brush was tough enough, but tightening shoes by wrapping strings together? Nothing easy about that. Besides, who needs them? Wear loafers. Go barefoot. Who came up with the ideas of shoes, anyhow? And knees don't help. Always in your face, leaning around them, pushing them away. A person can't concentrate. And oh, the advice! Everyone had a different approach. Make a tree with a loop and let the squirrel run around it into the hole. Shape a rabbit ear and then wrap it with a ribbon. Dad said, go fast. Your uncle said to take your time. Can't anyone agree only on one thing? You need to know how. Learning to tie your shoes is a rite of passage. Right in there with first grade and first bike is first shoe tying. But oh, how dreadful is the process. Just when you think you've made the loops and circled the tree, you get the rabbit ears in either hand and give them a triumphant yank and voila, a knot. Unbeknownst to you, you've just been inducted into reality. My friend Roy used to sit on a park bench for a few minutes each morning. He liked to watch the kids gather and play at the bus stop. One day he noticed a little fellow, maybe 5 or 6 years of age, struggling to board the bus. While others were climbing on, he was leaning down, frantically trying to disentangle a knotted shoestring. He grew more anxious by the moment, frantic eyes darting back and forth between the shoe and the ride. All of a sudden, it was too late. The door closed. The boy fell back on his haunches and sighed. That's when he saw Roy. With tear-filled eyes, he looked at the man on the bench and asked, "Do you untie knots?" Jesus loves that request. Life gets tangled. People mess up. You never outgrow the urge to look up and say, "Help!" Jesus had a way of appearing at such moments. Peter's empty boat. Nicodemus's empty heart. Matthew has a friend issue. A woman has a health issue. Look who shows up. Jesus, our next door Savior. Do you untie knots? Yes. Christ's theme song. Most families keep their family secrets a secret. Most don't talk about the swindling uncle or the street-walking great aunt. Such stories remain unmentioned at the family reunion and unrecorded in the family Bible. That is, unless you are the God-man. Jesus displays the bad apples of his family tree in the first chapter of the New Testament. You've barely dipped a toe into Matthew's gospel when you realize Jesus hails from the Tilted Halo Society. Rahab was a Jericho harlot. Grandpa Jacob was slippery enough to warrant an electric ankle bracelet. David had a personality as irregular as a Picasso painting, one day writing psalms, another day seducing his captain's wife. But did Jesus erase his name from the list? Not at all. You'd think he would have. Entertainment Tonight could quarry a season of gossip out of these stories. Why did Jesus hang his family's dirty laundry on the neighborhood's clothesline? Because your family has some, too. An uncle with a prison record. The dad who never came home. The grandparent who ran away with the co-worker. If your family tree has bruised fruit, then Jesus wants you to know, I've been there. The phrase, I've been there, is in the chorus of Christ's theme song. To the lonely, Jesus whispers, I've been there. To the discouraged, Christ nods his head and sighs, I've been there. Just look at his hometown, a sleepy, humble, forgotten hamlet. To find its parallel in our world, where would we go? We'd leave the United States. We'd bypass Europe and most of Latin America. Israel wasn't a superpower or a commercial force or a vacation resort. The land Joshua settled and Jesus loved barely registered on the Roman Empire radar screen, but it was there. Caesar's soldiers occupied it, like Poland in the 19th.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.